Please welcome our host for today's contest, Arts Education Director of the Mississippi Arts Commission, Charlotte Smelser.
On behalf of the Mississippi Arts Commission and our partners, the National Endowment for the Arts and the Poetry Foundation, I welcome you to the 11th Annual Poetry Out Loud Mississippi Recitation Contest. This year, more than 370,000 students in nearly 2,400 schools have participated in Poetry Out Loud, a poetry education program that's offered free of charge to high school students and teachers across our nation. The highlight of the program is the National Recitation Contest, in which 53 contestants, one from each of the 50 states, from Puerto Rico, the U.S. Virgin Islands, and the District of Columbia, will recite for up to $20,000 in prize money. 38 high schools from across our state, from Meridian to Vicksburg and from South Haven to Biloxi, began the journey toward today's contest when they registered to participate in Mississippi's Poetry Out Loud program at the beginning of the academic year. In some schools, this began in the English classroom, in others, in the theater classroom, and still others, with an interested teacher or club advisor. This led to an in-school Poetry Out Loud contest that was held just before the winter holidays. 4,124 students and 130 teachers have participated in Mississippi's Poetry Out Loud this year. In February, the school champions represented their schools at one of three regional contests held across the state. And from those three regional contests, the top three scoring contestants will be reciting here today. There'll be three rounds in today's contest. Each contestant has prepared three poems, and each will recite one in round one and another in round two. The top three scoring contestants will then each recite their third poem to determine who will represent Mississippi at the National Recitation Contest in Washington, D.C. in May. With my personal best wishes to all the contestants, it's my pleasure now to introduce our Master of Ceremonies for this contest. Kevin Farrell is the Assistant Director of Radio for Mississippi Public Broadcasting. Raised in Hattiesburg, he attended the University of Southern Mississippi, graduating with a Bachelor of Arts degree in radio, television, and film production in 1984. During his 31 years with Mississippi Public Broadcasting, Farrell has served as a reporter, producer, and operations manager. Currently, he's the host for a number of local informational shows that air weekday mornings on Think Radio. Please welcome Mississippi Public Broadcasting's own Kevin Farrell.
Thank you, Charlotte, and thanks also to our guest musicians from the Pine Belt Pickers, Kyle Bauman and Ben Stedman. Welcome, and let me first tell you how proud Mississippi Public Broadcasting is to share Poetry Out Loud with our statewide television audience. We believe that academic contests should and do stand on the same stage as all other pursuits of excellence, and that the contestants deserve not only our attention, but our respect. Poetry Out Loud seeks to promote the art of poetry in both the classroom and the community. The program provides an entry point for many students to learn to love poetry, and for many, to introduce them to poems that will stay with them for a lifetime. Poetry Out Loud judges evaluate each recitation independently using a predefined six-level scoring system. In addition, an accuracy judge follows the text to monitor accuracy, and a prompter is available if a contestant requires assistance. Judging recitations is one of the most important and most difficult aspects of Poetry Out Loud. Judges are asked to evaluate very different recitations, each displaying an impressive level of excellence, and they must decide how well students represent complex poem that may lend themselves to more than one interpretation. The integrity of Poetry Out Loud rests on the work of the judges at each and every level of the contest. Serving on today's panel of judges are poet and short story writer and instructor of English at Jackson State University, C. Lee McInnes. Author, Mississippi Arts Commission roster artist and teaching artist, and Mississippi Humanities speaker, Rochelle Putnam. Assistant Professor in the School of Journalism and Media Studies at Jackson State University, Dr. Monica Flippenwin. Artistic Director of Jackson's New Stage Theater, Francine Reynolds. Poet, writer, and Mississippi Arts Commission roster artist, Dr. Benjamin Morris. And courtesy of the Mississippi Arts Commission, our accuracy judge is Connie Soto-Lehrman, our prompter is Diane Williams, and tabulating the scores are Shirley Smith and Emily Shafali. Poetry Out Loud recitations are scored in five categories: physical presence, voice and articulation, dramatic appropriateness, evidence of understanding, and overall performance. It's interesting to note that Poetry Out Loud is not a competition, it's a contest. If it were a competition, the contestants would all be reciting the same poems, and the judges would be choosing one recitation over another. In Poetry Out Loud, the judges evaluate each recitation independently according to the five scoring categories using a predefined six-level scoring system. In other words, the judges don't select the finalists, the scores do. And now we begin round one of the Poetry Out Loud 2016 Mississippi Recitation Contest.
The Obligation to be Happy by Linda Paston. It is more onerous than the rites of beauty or housework, harder than love. But you expect it of me casually, the way you expect the sun to come up, not in spite of rain or clouds, but because of them. And so I smile as if my own fidelity to sadness were a hidden vice, that downward tug on my mouth, my old suspicion that health and love are brief irrelevancies, no more than laughter in the warm dark strangled at dawn. Happiness. I try to hoist it on my narrow shoulders again, a knapsack heavy with gold coins. I stumble around the house, bump into things. Only Midas himself would understand.
Refusing Silence by Tess Gallagher. Heartbeat, trembling your kingdom of leaves near the ceremony of water. I never insisted on you. I admit I delayed. I was the Empress of Delay. But it can't be put off now. On the sacred branch of my only voice, I insist for us all, which is the job of the voice, and especially of the poet. Else what am I for? What use am I if I don't insist? There are messages to send, gatherings, and songs, because we need to insist. Else, what are we for? What use are we?
Domestic Situation by Ernest Hilbert. Maybe you've heard about this. Maybe not. A man came home and chucked his girlfriend's cat in the wood chipper. This really happened. Dinner wasn't ready on time. A lot of other little things went wrong. He spat on her father, who came out when he learned about it. He also broke her pinky stole her checks and got her sister pregnant. But she stood by him, stood strong through it all, because she loved him. She loved him. You see, she actually said that. And then she went and married him. She felt some unique call. Don't try to understand what another person means by love. Don't even bother.
Weighing In by Rena P. Espaya. What the scale tells you is how much the earth has missed you, body, how it wants you back again after you leave it to go forth into the light. Do you remember how earth hardly noticed you then? Others would rock you in their arms, warm in the flow that fed you, coaxed you upright. Then earth began to claim you with spots and fevers, began to lick at you with a bruised knee, a bloody shin, and finally to stoke you, body, drumming intimate coded messages through music you dance to unawares. There in your dreaming and your poems and your obedient blood. Body, how useful you became. How lucky. Heavy with news and breakage. Rich. And sad. Sometimes imagining that greedy zero you must have been. That promising empty sack of possibilities. Never to come tomorrow. But look at you now, body. Soft old shoe that love wears when it's stirring. Look down. Look how earth wants what you weigh, needs what you know.
Personal by Tony Hoagland. Don't take it personal, they said, but I did. I took it all quite personal. The breeze and the river and the color of the fields. The price of grapefruit and stamps. The wet hair of women in the rain. And I cursed what hurt me, and I praised what gave me joy, the most simple-minded of possible responses. The government reminded me of my father, with its deafness and its laws, and the weather reminded me of my mom, with her tropical squalls. Enjoy it while you can, they said of happiness. Think first, they said of talk. Get over it, they said at the school of broken hearts. But I couldn't, and I didn't, and I don't believe in the clean break. I believe in the compound fracture served with a sauce of dirty regret. I believe in saying it all and taking it all back and saying it again while the air fills up with I'm sorry's like wheeling birds and the trees look seasick in the wind. Oh, life, can you blame me for making a scene? You were that yellow caboose, the moon disappearing over a ridge of cloud. I was the dog, chained in some fool's backyard, barking and barking, trying to convince everything else to take it personal, too.
There Are Birds Here by Jamal May for Detroit. There are birds here. So many birds here is what I was trying to say when they said those birds were metaphors for what is trapped between buildings and buildings. No. The birds are here to root around for bread the girls' hands tear and toss like confetti. No, I don't mean the bread is torn like cotton. I said confetti. And no, not the confetti a tank can make of a building. I mean the confetti a boy can't stop smiling about. And no, his smile isn't much like a skeleton at all. And no, his neighborhood is not like a war zone. I am trying to say his neighborhood is as tattered and feathered as anything else. As shadow pierced by sun and light parted by shadow dance as anything else. But they won't stop saying how lovely the ruins, how ruined the lovely children must be in that birdless city.
Fishing on the Susquehanna in July by Billy Collins. I have never been fishing on the Susquehanna or on any other river for that matter, to be perfectly honest. Not in July or any month have I had the pleasure, if it is a pleasure, of fishing on the Susquehanna. I am more likely to be found in a quiet room, like this one, a painting of a woman on the wall, a bowl of tangerines on the table, trying to manufacture the sensation of fishing on the Susquehanna. There is little doubt that others have been fishing on the Susquehanna, rowing upstream in a wooden boat, sliding the oars under the water, then raising them to drip in the light. But the nearest I have ever come to fishing on the Susquehanna was one afternoon in a museum in Philadelphia, when I balanced a little egg of time in front of a painting in which that river curled around a bend under a blue cloud-ruffled sky, dense trees along the banks, and a fellow with a red bandana sitting in a small, green, flat-bottom boat holding the thin whip of a pole. That is something I am unlikely ever to do, I remember saying to myself and the person next to me. Then I blinked and moved on to other American scenes of haystacks, water whitening over rocks, even one of a brown hare, who seemed so wired with alertness, I imagined him springing right out of the frame.
The Art Room by Shara McCallum for My Sisters. Because we did not have threads of turquoise, silver, and gold, we could not sew a sun nor sky.
and our hands became balls of fire, and our arms spread open like wings. Because we had no chalk or pastels, no toad, forest, or morning grass slats of paper, we had no color for creatures. So we squatted and sprang. Four young girls' plaits heavy on our backs. Our feet were beating drums, drawing rhythms from the floor. Our mouths became woodwinds. Our tongues touched teeth and were reeds.
Vita Nova by Louise Gluck. You saved me. You should remember me. The spring of the year. Young men buying tickets for the ferry boats. Laughter, because the air is full of apple blossoms. When I woke up, I realized I was capable of the same feeling. I remember sounds like that from my childhood. Laughter for no cause, simply because the world is beautiful. Something like that. Lugano. Tables under the apple trees. Deckhands raising and lowering the colored flags. And by the lake's edge, a young man throws his hat into the water. Perhaps his sweetheart has accepted him. Crucial sounds or gestures, like a track laid down before the larger themes and then unused, buried. Islands in the distance. My mother holding out a plate of little cakes. As far as I remember, changed in no detail, the moment vivid, intact, having never been exposed to light so that I woke elated at my age, hungry for life, utterly confident. By the tables, patches of new grass, the pale green pieced into the dark existing ground. Surely, spring has been returned to me, this time not as a lover, but a messenger of death. Yet, it is still spring. It is still meant tenderly.
This concludes round one of the Poetry Out Loud 2016 Mississippi Recitation Contest. We'll now proceed directly to round two, during which we'll hear a second recitation from each contestant.
Poem About People by Robert Pinsky. The jaunty, crop-haired, graying women in grocery stores, their clothes boyish and neat, new mittens or clean sneakers, clean hands, hips not bad still, buying ice cream, steaks, soda, fresh melons, and soap. Or the big balding young men in work shoes and green work pants, beer belly and white t-shirt. The porky walk back to the truck, polite. Possible to feel briefly like Jesus, a gust of diffused tenderness crossing the dark spaces to where the dry self burrows or nests, something that stirs, watching the kinds of people on the street for a while. But how love falters and flags when anyone's difficult eyes come into focus. Terrible gaze of a unique soul, its need unlovable.
my friend, in his divorced school teacher apartment, his own unsuspected paintings hung everywhere, which his wife kept in a closet. Not, he says, that she wasn't perfectly right. Or me, mishearing my rock radio sing my self-pity. The angels wished him dead. All the hideous sudden stare of self, soul showing through like the lizard ancestry, showing in the frontal gaze of a robin busy on the lawn. In the movies, when the sensitive, young, Jewish soldier nearly drowns trying to rescue the thrashing, anti-Semitic bully, swimming across the river raked by Nazi fire, the awful part is the part truth. Hate my whole kind, but me, love me for myself. The weather changes in the black of night, and the dream wind bowling across the sopping open spaces of roads, golf courses, parking lots, flails a commotion in the dripping treetops, tries a half-rotten shingle or a down-hung branch. And we all dream it, the dark wind crossing the wide spaces between us.
Give All to Love by Ralph Waldo Emerson. Give all to love. Obey thy heart. Friends, kindred, days, estate, good fame, plans, credit, and the muse. Nothing refuse. 'Tis a brave master. Let it have scope. Follow it utterly. Hope beyond hope, high and more high. It dives into noon with wing unspent, untold intent. But it is a god. Knows its own path and the outlets of the sky. It was never for the mean. It requireth courage, stout, souls above doubt, valor unbending. It will reward. They shall return more than they were and ever ascending. Leave all for love. Yet hear me. Yet one word more thy heart behoved, one pulse more of firm endeavor. Keep thee today, tomorrow, forever, free as an Arab of thy beloved. Cling with life to the maid, but when the surprise, first vague shadow of surmise, flits across her bosom young, of a joy apart from thee, free be she, fancy free. Nor thou detain her vesture's hem, nor the palest rose she flung from her summer diadem. Though thou loved her as thyself, a self of purer clay, though her parting dims the day, stealing grace from all alive, heartily know, when half gods go, the gods arrive.
Sweet Tooth by Russell Edson. A little girl, made of sugar and spice and everything nice, was eaten by someone with a sweet tooth the size of an elephant's tusk. Ah, he said, this darn tooth, it's driving me nuts. And then another voice is heard. It's the little girl's father who says, "Have you seen a little girl made of sugar and spice and everything nice? Incidentally, what's that thing sticking out of your mouth like an elephant's tusk?" "My sweet tooth, and it's really driving me nuts. You ought to see a dentist, but he might want to pull it, and I don't like people pulling at me. If they want to pull, they should pull at their own pullables." "So true," said the little girl's father. "People should pull at their own pullables and let other people's pullables alone. But still," he asked again, "I wonder if you've seen a little girl made of sugar and spice and everything nice."
Dirge Without Music by Edna St. Vincent Millay. I am not resigned to the shutting away of loving hearts in the hard ground. So it is, and so it will be, for so it has been time out of mind. Into the darkness they go, the wise and the lovely, crowned with lilies and with laurel, they go. But I am not resigned. Lovers and thinkers, into the earth with you. Be one with the dull, the indiscriminate dust. A fragment of what you felt, of what you knew, a formula, a phrase remains. But the best is lost. The answers quick and keen, the honest look, the laughter, the love, they are gone. They are gone to feed the roses. Elegant and curled is the blossom. Fragrant is the blossom. I know. But I do not approve. More precious was the light in your eyes than all the roses in the world. Down, down, down into the darkness of the grave. Gently they go, the beautiful, the tender, the kind. Quietly they go, the intelligent, the witty, the brave. I know, but I do not approve, and I am not resigned.
Experience by Edith Wharton. Like Crusoe with the bootless gold, we stand upon the desert verge of death and say, "What shall avail the woes of yesterday to buy tomorrow's wisdom in the land whose currency is strange into our hand?" In life's small market, they had served to pay some late-found rapture. Could we but delay till time hath matched our means to our demand. But otherwise fate wills it. For behold, our gathered strength of individual pain, when time's long alchemy hath made it gold, dies with us, hoarded all these years in vain, since those that might be heir to it, the mold renew and coin themselves new griefs again. O death, we come full-handed to thy gate, rich with strange burden of the mingled years. gains and renunciations, mirth and tears, and love's oblivion, and remembering hate. Nor know we what compulsion laid such freight upon our souls. And shall our hopes and fears by nothing of thee, death? Behold our wares, and sell us the one joy for which we wait. Had we lived longer, like had such for sale with the last coin of sorrow purchased cheap. But now we stand before thy shadowy pale, and all our longings lie within thy keep. Death, can it be the years shall naught avail? Not so, Death answered. They shall purchase sleep.
Personal by Tony Hoagland. Don't take it personal, they said. But I did. I took it all quite personal. The breeze and the river and the color of the fields, the price of grapefruit and stamps, the wet hair of women in the rain. And I cursed what hurt me, and I praised what gave me joy, the most simple-minded of possible responses. The government reminded me of my father with its deafness and its laws. And the weather reminded me of my mom with her tropical squalls. Enjoy it while you can, they said of happiness. Think first, they said of talk. Get over it, they said at the School of Broken Hearts, but I couldn't and I didn't. And I don't believe in the clean break. I believe in the compound fracture served with a sauce of dirty regret. I believe in saying it all and taking it all back and saying it again for good measure while the air fills up with I'm sorry's like wheeling birds and the trees look seasick in the wind. Oh, life. Can you blame me for making a scene? You were that yellow caboose, the moon disappearing over a ridge of cloud. I was the dog, chained in some fool's backyard, barking and barking, trying to convince everything else to take it personal, too.
Novel by Arthur Rimbaud. We aren't serious when we're 17. One fine evening, to hell with beer and lemonade, noisy cafes with their shining lamps. We walk under the green linden trees of the park. The lindens smell good in the good June evenings. At times the air is so scented that we close our eyes. The wind laden with sounds. The town isn't far. Has the smell of grapevines and beer. There, you can see a very small patch of dark blue, framed by a little branch, pinned up by a naughty star that melts in gentle quivers, small and very white. Night in June, 17 years old. We are overcome by it all. The sap is champagne and goes to our head. We talked a lot and feel a kiss on our lips, trembling there like a small insect. Our wild heart moves through novels like Robinson Crusoe when, in the light of a pale street lamp, a girl goes by. Attractive and charming. Under the shadow of her father's terrible collar. And as she finds you incredibly naive, while clicking her little boots, she turns abruptly and in a lively way. Then cavatinas die on your lips. You are in love. Occupied until the month of August, you are in love. Your sonnets make her laugh. All your friends go off. You are ridiculous. Then, one evening, the girl you worship deigned to write to you. That evening, you return to the bright cafes. You ask for beer or lemonade. We're not serious when we are 17. And when we have green linden trees in the park.
A Fixed Idea by Amy Lowell. What torture lurks within a single thought when grown too constant? And however kind, however welcome, still the weary mind aches with its presence. Dull remembrance taught remembers on unceasingly. Unsought, the old delight is with us. But to find that all recurring joy is pain refined, become a habit, and we struggle, caught. You lie upon my heart as on a nest, folded in peace. For you can never know how crushed I am with having you at rest, heavy upon my life. I love you, so you bind my freedom from its rightful quest. In mercy, lift your drooping wings and go.
Under the Vulture Tree by David Bottoms. We have all seen them circling pastures, have looked up from the mouth of a barn, a pine clearing, the fences of our own backyards, and have stood amazed by the one slow wing beat, the endless dihedral drift. But I had never seen so many so close, hundreds, every limb of the dead oak feathered black. And I cut the engine, let the river grab the John boat and pull it toward the tree. The black leaves shined. The pink fruit blossomed red, ugly as a human heart. Then, as I passed under their dream, I saw for the first time its soft countenance, the raw, fleshy jowls wrinkled and generous, like the faces of the very old who have grown to empathize with everything. And I drifted away from them, slow, on the pull of the river, reluctant, looking back at their roost, calling them what I'd never called them, what they are. Those dwarfed, transfiguring angels who flock to the side of the poisoned fox, the mud turtle crushed on the shoulder of the road, who pray over the leaf graves of the anonymous lost, with mercy enough to consume us all and give us wings.
Welcome back for the final round of Poetry Out Loud 2016 Mississippi Recitation Contest. The scores from the first and second rounds have been tabulated, and the three highest scoring contestants will now each recite a third poem. The scores they earn in this round will be added to their standing scores and will be used to select Mississippi's representative to the Poetry Out Loud National Recitation Contest to be held in Washington, D.C. on May 3rd and 4th. The contestants in alphabetical order are Emma Gousset, Brittany Harrow, and Lawson Marchetti. Congratulations, now we begin the third and final round of the Poetry Out Loud 2016 Mississippi Recitation Contest. First up is Emma Gousset, a junior at Tupelo High School.
The Maid's Lament by Walter Savage Landor. I loved him not, and yet, now he is gone, I feel I am alone. I checked him while he spoke, yet could he speak? Alas, I would not check. For reasons not to love him once I sought, and wearied all my thought to vex myself and him. I now would give my love, could he but live, who lately lived for me. And when he found 'twas vain, in holy ground, he hid his face amid the shades of death. I waste for him my breath, who wasted his for me, but mine returns. And this lorn bosom burns with stifling heat, heaving it up in sleep and waking me to weep tears that had melted his soft heart. For years wept he as bitter tears. Merciful God, such was his latest prayer, these may she never share. Quieter is his breast more cold than daisies in the mold. Where children spell athwart the churchyard gate his name and life's brief date. Pray for him, gentle souls, whoe'er you be. And oh, pray too for me.
Next is Brittany Harrow, a senior at St. Martin School.
Sonnets from the Portuguese 43, How Do I Love Thee? Let Me Count the Ways, by Elizabeth Barrett Browning. How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. I love thee to the depth and breadth and height my soul can reach when feeling out of sight for the ends of being and ideal grace. I love thee to the level of every day's most quiet need, by sun and candlelight. I love thee freely as men strive for right. I love thee purely as they turn from praise. I love thee with the passion put to use in my old griefs and with my childhood's faith. I love thee with the love I seem to lose with my lost saints. I love thee with the breath, smiles, tears of all my life. And if God choose, I shall but love thee better after death.
Our final recitation is by Lawson Marchetti, a junior at Jackson Preparatory School.
Every Single Day by John Straley, after Raymond Carver's Hummingbird. Suppose I said the word springtime, and I wrote the words King Salmon on a piece of paper and mailed it to you. When you opened it, would you remember that afternoon we spent together in the yellow boat when the early whales were feeding and we caught our first fish of the year? Or would you remember that time off Cape Flattery when you were a little girl? Your father smoking, telling stories as he ran the boat. Then the tug and zing of that very first fish spooling off into the gray green world. You laughing and brushing back your hair before setting the hook. I know I'm hard to understand sometimes, particularly when you were standing at the post office with only a piece of paper saying King Salmon on it. But just think of it as a promissory note. And that electric tug, that thrill pulling your mind into deep water, is how I feel about you every single day.
And now the announcement that you've all been waiting to hear, the naming of our third and second place finalists and of our 2016 state champion. With me on stage to present this year's awards is Malcolm White, the Executive Director of the Mississippi Arts Commission. The 2016 Mississippi Poetry Out Loud third place finalist is Brittany Harrow. The 2016 Mississippi Poetry Out Loud second place finalist and recipient of a $100 award and a $200 stipend for her school library is Emma Gousset. So that means that the 2016 Mississippi Poetry Out Loud state champion and recipient of a $200 award and an all-expense-paid trip for two to Washington, D.C. and a $500 stipend for his school library is Lawson Marchetti.
you, Kevin Farrell. And thanks to Kyle Bowman and Ben Stedman, our amazing musicians. Congratulations. And thanks to everyone who contributed to the success of Poetry Out Loud, the teachers, the students, the coaches, the clinicians, the volunteers, the judges, and to the schools, the businesses, and the organizations who partnered with the Mississippi Arts Commission to bring this great program to the students of our state, including the Yoknapatawpha Arts Council in Oxford, the Margaret Walker Alexander National Research Center at Jackson State University, the Lauren Rogers Museum of Art in Laurel, the Lafayette County and Oxford Public Library, Parkway Heights United Methodist Church in Hattiesburg, the Mary C. O'Keefe Cultural Center of Arts and Education in Ocean Springs, and of course, Mississippi Public Broadcasting. Registration for 2017 Poetry Out Loud Mississippi Contest will be Thursday, May the 5th. Any and all schools that teach students in grades 9 through 12 are encouraged to go to the Mississippi Arts Commission's website at www.arts.ms.gov to find more information about the contest. This concludes Poetry Out Loud 2016. We hope you'll join us again next year.